Hello and welcome to SBS 300. Today I'm going to be reviewing with you two of the most interesting schools, in my opinion, of social theory of the 20th century. One is phenomenology and the second one is ethnomethodology, all of which frame or are related to the whole school of social interactionism that we explored already this week. So let's get started with the presentation. I'd like to first start with a definition of phenomenology that we didn't cover quite the other session. Phenomenology is, as its own title indicates, is the study of phenomena. And phenomena we should understand as how things appear to our field of vision and in social terms. This comes from a long-standing Greek discussion that was later picked up by existentialist philosophers in the 20th century that questions the very nature of the reality that we know. So I want you to think for a moment that everything we know because it comes to us through our senses, unless you believe in innate ideas and conceptions, which has been another way of explaining things. Think for example of Plato and idealist philosophers who really thought that humans did have ideas and notions that were pre-ingrained in themselves, and because they had those ideas and notions, then we were able to navigate the world. But then the alternative view is that everything we know, and this comes from Aristotle, comes to us from the senses. In any event, and not to dwell too much into this discussion of what comes first, in sciences and in social sciences, the method calls for an empirical approach, and empirical means the senses. That's what the word empirios means in Greek, senses. So phenomenology considers this and says, yeah, okay, so we know what we see, we know what we experience, but ultimately we know inside of ourselves. We know, think of it. We get light that is actually generating this image of me that you're seeing today is impacting your retina, and then the transformation of the photons of those particles that are hitting or waves that are hitting your eyes, all the transformation happens in your brains inside of you, not outside of you. So I'm not real today, because you're seeing just an image of me. I'm recording this, I have already recorded this many hours before the session. So is this me that is talking to you, or is this computer that you have in front of you, the screen that is in front of you, me? What if someone doctored the image, and I'm not saying this, and actually there are some programs out there today that can simulate speech of individuals, and so you can actually type some sentences and then the computer will render both the voice and the image of the individual and then represent that or transcribe that sentence that was typed on a keyboard, and that is represented by the image. Some of the video games that you're familiar with are just incredibly realistic. So the reality that is out there is a representation of a representation, so it gets complicated. All it is, just not to make it too much convoluted for you, is that it really questions whether or not we can ascertain, we can reach out and touch the reality out there. The only thing that we can actually touch is what comes to us and what we can process in our minds. So it is appropriate to question if we can attain a knowledge of the things in and of themselves, or we can only ascertain what it is presented to us. So you know me just a fraction of who I am. And almost anyone will get to know me for what I am in, on my entire self. You know my instructional self, and you know my professional self, but that's what you know. And even my close family, even your close family, will know something of you, but not all of you. There was this famous window of Joe Harris. I will say we can divvy up the knowable in four windows. One is things that we know of ourselves and others know of ourselves, so everyone knows. Then there's other window, things that I know of myself but others do not know of myself. And then there's another window in which there are stuff that other people know of myself and I don't know of myself. And then lastly, there's the blackout window, is stuff that I don't know of myself and people don't know of myself. So it's the unknown. The point again is it is complicated. It is not just face value. We need to consider how complicated it is to get to know things. There's the whole of this science of gnoseology or epistemology, how we know things. How is it that we know things? So in this realm, as sociological theorists and social theorists start questioning whether or not we can really approach and understand the social reality as an externality. There's the Greeks used to divvy up the world in between phenomena, which is what it is presented to us, and noumena, which is the actual thing in and of itself. The essence of things. Can we really reach out and touch and see and experiment or understand the essence of things, or we have to just simply rely on what is presented of us from that essence? And I think that's it's the latter, the most likely response. One thing that they in phenomenology and ethnomethodology do agree is that we can only know from our subjective point of view, and that is something that is hard to object to. We can only know from our own individual perspective. You're sitting at a specific chair at a specific place right now, and you're listening to what I'm saying, and you're elaborating, thinking, connecting in very specific ways that is different from the ways in which your peers are connecting what I'm saying, because we have different experiences, different moments. Maybe you're in an unhappy mood, maybe you're in a happy mood, maybe you're in an inquisitive mode right now, or maybe not. And so what I'm saying, which is apparently the same to everyone in the classroom, will have different, slightly different meanings, or profoundly different meanings, depending on what's going on. All right, so the takeout or the things that we have to remember is that in the 20th century, there's a bunch of schools, philosophical schools, that will question the nature of reality. And Husserl, which is a German philosopher, that is the one that brings the whole current of phenomenology, he states that we can only be sure of those things that our thinking allows. We can only be sure of things that our thinking allows. That's pretty self-explanatory. We can only think what we think, right? We cannot think something else. And we can only then be sure of what we think. And the rest is that objective reality out there. It's something that we might or might not apprehend or understand in its entirety. So, if you take that approach that Husserl is presenting for on a philosophical stage, and you take it into sociology, this is what it means. And Schutz is another author that we should probably consider as an important social theorist, but we don't have enough time. He brings that into sociology, and he says, then if we cannot ascertain the external reality in itself, then we can only, at best, construct the social world in terms of how individuals construct the social world. So that reality out there, we're not going to be able to touch. We can only touch as individuals what individuals construct. And that's actually what society is. That calls for a fundamental revision of the theory of sociological problems. In other words, it challenges directly this assertion by Durkheim that the objective of sociology should be that external reality that is constituted in a social fact. See, we can never ascertain that. We can only ascertain as individuals what individuals ascertain, but not an objective reality out there. And that also calls for a revision of sociological methods. So, in other words, there's a profound questioning of the approach that has been followed in social theory to understand the social, as if there's a non-problematic reaching out to social reality. It is problematic, and actually maybe it is unattainable, because we can only know what we can think, and the thinking is in here in the individual. So it's a fundamental call for sociologists and social theory to look inwards as opposed to try to look outwards, if this makes sense to you. Out of these, you have currents, constructivism and ethnomethodology. Constructivism is social reality is constructed, symbolic interactionism, and then an ethnomethodology, as we will see in a moment, ethnomethodology will explore the methods, that is the strategies that we follow as individuals with in relationship with other individuals, hence the ethno, which means the collective peoples, to create the social reality. And that's what the meaning of ethnomethodology is. Strategies to construct with others the social reality. Right, so let's dig a little deeper. Harold Garfinkel is the individual who starts this exploration. So here's the question. Why do we presuppose unproblematically that the social world is orderly intrinsically? That we're just sort of born into a social reality that is completely organized and ready for us. We have to instead start with the assumption that the social order is an illusion, is something that is just presented to us as a phenomenon, and that it is actually constructed in the minds of the social actors. And in this construction in the minds of social actors is that we create the reality of the external world, not vice versa. So all the other authors we've been exploring have been telling us the social world comes to you and informs your behavior. And what Harold Garfinkel, following this questioning that comes from phenomenology, it would say, no, it's actually all social actors that are constantly organizing and reorganizing that social external world. The ethnomethodological approach studies the interaction through enacted conduct so that it is similar to the perspective of myth and symbolic interactionism. So here's the question. How do we construct our context? And how is this interaction happening, right? And what are the rules of engagement? So ethnomethodology, and in other words, probably sociology, should be understood as the study of a particular subject matter. The body of common sense knowledge and the range of procedures and considerations by means of which ordinary members of society make sense of and find their way about in and act on the circumstances in which they find themselves. So it's how do we learn to navigate the circumstances and how do we create meaning there? If you don't believe that we create meaning and that we have the mechanisms ingrained in our brains to create mechanisms, let me show you this little clip. Let's see if it runs. So it's so funny that the little guy is trying to understand what the other is saying. And then there's this negotiation of what to do and what it means, and one does one thing and the other does that thing, and there's some communication going on there. So these little guys, I think it's so funny. These little guys are creating meaning, are negotiating the meaning, and are positioning themselves, who takes the lead, who follows, who is in agreement, who is in disagreement, and they don't even know how to speak just yet, but yeah, they have the capacity to create meaning and negotiate meaning. So definitely there's something going on there in terms of how we create the meaning. And I think those are the elementary forms of creating meaning. We have that ability, and that might be innate. So Harold Garfinkel, born and raised in New Jersey, and what's interesting, I wanted to point out the fact that he was trained by Talcott Parsons. So he is in Chicago exactly when Talcott Parsons and his group of colleagues are really thinking about this redefinition of social sciences around the idea of social action. And so what Garfinkel did as a student was to be interested not in social action in itself, but in the strategies that are used by actors to analyze the circumstances. In other words, for those two babies, he will be interested in understanding the mechanisms by which one conveys meaning, the other one receives the meaning, and then how that gets cemented into an agreement in terms of what's okay to do for common action, right? So his interest will be in the strategy by which actors analyze circumstances and carry out courses of action, which he defines as ethno-methodology. So here's the problem though. If nothing has a fixed meaning and everything is dependent on context, of which, as we know, all the other authors that we have explored, Marx, Weber, Durkheim, will be totally confused and uncomfortable with, if there's no fixed meaning out there, that this meaning or this social class or power structures that we are born into, then how can we even communicate? There's got to be that structure already there so that we can communicate. So they would be totally confused. To that, Garfinkel and ethno-methodologies will respond for reflexivity. We have the means to understand, we have the ability to understand the meanings within situations. So we can easily navigate and we can communicate because we have the ability to understand the meanings in given situations. I'm gonna play another short clip that precisely, this is a clip that that was put together by a show that is called Just for Laughs. And in a clip, they will present a third party, an individual that is unsuspected, what's going on, without speaking, with a circumstance that needs to be tended to in ways that they were not used to do in the past. So you will see how individuals actually read the context and react to the context in a hilarious way. Obviously, we have the ability to make sense, or if we don't make sense, at least to behave in certain ways depending on the context that we have. So we have the ability to communicate, probably an innate ability to communicate and create meaning, and we have the ability to react, read, and then negotiate, maybe recreate the rules of engagement in different social situations. So if there's no pre-existing order, we can certainly create that order. And based on this idea is that they proposed and create their new representations of how social action is generated and carried out. It's interesting in that certainly societies change through time, so this will be a wonderful, very powerful methodological and theoretical approach to understand change through time. Marx wanted to understand change in terms of violent clashes between larger social forces that he defined as social classes, but they instead are asking us to look into the individual action as the source of understanding for social change and transformation. So it is true that the social order is fragile because it changes. We know how rapidly things can change in a society. And because social order is fragile, then Carl Finkel actually was looking for ways to demonstrate that the social order could be challenged easily. So he asked his graduate students to go home, and maybe I should ask you to do this when you go home for the Thanksgiving break, and behave as if you were a guest at a hotel, at your place, at your home. So obviously your family is going to go nuts with you behaving in that bizarre way, because the rules of action and the normative framework that it's in place doesn't call for that type of protocol in which there's distance and certain level of somewhat artificial interaction with the people that are there. The closeness of a family context is challenged when you behave as if you were just a simple guest at a hotel, right? But that makes the rules surface, that makes the rules of engagement become evident when you break them, and then you can talk about those rules by making them evident. He saw, for example, in the very definition of suicide, Garfinkel work and studied coroners' attitudes and definitions about suicide. And he realized that the definitions and attitudes were very much so related, not so much to preconceived notions of what suicide was, but based on what they were seeing in their everyday work. So in that sense, the objective reality of suicide was not defined independently, but in the course of their everyday action and interaction. So here's the thing, whereas by Durkheim, there's an objective reality of social facts as a fundamental principle for social sciences. For Garfinkel, and that's a takeaway that is important, that objective reality exists, but it's actually produced socially, locally, and endogenously, that it's inwardly, from inside out, by individuals, and not outwardly and in an inward direction, as Talcott Parsons would pose, that we are receiving sort of the normative framework of action by means of socialization. And so Garfinkel is quite unhappy with that definition, and he is rather proposing that it's the interaction that creates that normativity that we can use for a moment and then challenge and change through time. Okay. Here's another little one. This is challenging the concept of boundaries and social and private property, and what's acceptable in terms of action. The guy is cleaning the car, and he can actually take out some of the dogs, so he's gonna fix it. Definitely. No more dust in the glass. Anyways, you get the point. I kind of like this show. Let's just recap. Big ideas. Marx has told us that we behave the way we behave as a result of our positions as members of social class, right? Weber instead will say that we behave based on values like ethics that predispose and explains our behavior. For Parsons, our behavior is framed and determined by values ingrained in us by means of socialization. In all these cases, Parsons, Weber, and Marx, all these cases show that there's an external reality that informs our individual action. Phenomenology challenges the ability that we have to reach out and find that external reality, and he asks us to actually look that inwardly to our internal state of being and how we do things internally. So what they say is that ultimately the reality is the individual. And the fact is that we create the frames of action through that reality, that individual reality. Symbolic interactionism confirms that It happens in our individual reality, but in as we interact with other individual realities. In that interaction, in which we're exchanging symbols, like the babies were exchanging, I don't know, views, ideas, behaviors, I don't know what they were exchanging. But it's by means of this interaction that we create meanings and recreate those meanings constantly. And that is the nature of social action. All right, and that's my presentation for phenomenology and ethnomethodology. Please look at the instructions right underneath this posting so that you can engage with your peers on a brief forum exercise. Thank you, and see you later.